Hello, everyone. How are you doing? Okay, great, awesome. I hope you had a great Pi day yesterday. And today we have a quite interesting day still ahead of us, promising AI track. And I would just like to do my part and talk a little bit about the machine learning landscape that we have today. So as announced, my name is Aiko. I work for a company called ThoughtWorks. And we are a consultancy, which means we build individual software for different clients and in different domains using different technologies. And we try to follow what we would consider the best practices. So we try to be agile, like actually agile. Try to follow things like test-driven development, continuous integration, continuous delivery, and pair programming. And we are also a huge fan of open source software. And so there's this one statistic that I found. So this is where the arrow, this is the company. And apparently we are number 8 on that list. So whatever, I mean, the statistic being used here is the employees, the number of employees contributing to open source software on GitHub. I'm sure there are other statistics. But I think it gives a nice idea that there is, that we do have some interest. And for a company with around 5,000 people, I think that's quite impressive, especially compared to some other lower on the list who are, have significantly more work power. All right. We also have an office in Singapore. So check it out. We do some meetups. I think Martin Fowler is coming next month. And obviously, as everyone in tech, we hire as well. Yeah, so working for a consultancy kind of makes me a consultant, but I would consider myself a developer. And my passion is machine learning. And that started when I was at university. I wrote my thesis about convolutional neural networks on mobile devices. And then later continued when I was working at clients at ThoughtWorks. And there's one particular client that I would like to tell you about that is that was the online retailer in Germany, the second largest behind Amazon. And what we did there was we used neural networks to predict orders based on browser session data. So we looked at the browser session data of users that were coming in, and then predicted how likely it is that that user will buy something within that session. And if it would be unlikely, we would offer some discounts or something like that. But enough about me. We're here to talk about machine learning. And so as heard before multiple times, and as we all know, AI, machine learning, all these terms are let's not say overhyped, let's say popular nowadays. And I think it would be good to get a common understanding of what these terms mean, at least in my understanding. And artificial intelligence, and I mean, we hear AI everywhere, especially in the AI track. Artificial intelligence, I would consider artificial intelligence, I like this definition that the OxfordDictionaries.com offers. A lot. And this is, by the way, also the definition you find when you ask Google to define artificial intelligence. And it basically is the theory and development of computer systems able to perform tasks normally requiring human intelligence. So that doesn't sound too crazy, does it? And one example that I like is a chess program where if you think of a person playing chess, you would assume that person has like some level of intelligence to be able to play chess. Now, if you make a computer play chess, then that is the artificial intelligence. But if you know how chess works, there are certain moves you can make, and then in the next round you can make certain other moves. You could basically brute force that, right? You could write a couple of if-else branches, and then you can brute force all the possible solutions, and then find the one that gives that makes you win that chess game. But then again, brute forcing and if-else isn't that crazy, right? So for me and for Oxford Dictionaries, the the definition of AI is less a technical, more like a you know what I mean. Rather technical, but more philosophic. Oh, shit. Right. Yes, who was it? Thank you very much. But then, so nothing fancy so far, but where the fancy part starts for me is machine learning, where this defining your algorithm and that then follows step by step to achieve something isn't really the case anymore. Like in machine learning, where the way of solving a problem, the way the algorithm works, is actually defined by the data we put into a machine. And if we put in different data or we put in more data, the way of how the algorithm solves the problem changes. And that's where I think the fancy part starts. And then there are neural networks, which is a subset of machine learning modeled after the human brain, where you have like neurons and they are connected to each other and send signals. And then deep learning, which is probably the most hyped one, is basically just a neural network with lots of layers, like a deep structure. And then there's data science, and we've heard that term before as well. And data science is basically extracting valuable information out of, or insights out of data. And it can use these methods, but it doesn't particularly have to. So the question is, why do we need machine learning? So there are a couple of use cases where machine learning just simply outperforms other approaches. And one thing that machine learning can do is it can find non-obvious correlations in a set of data. Going back to the online retailer that I was working with, we had like 700 data points of browser session data. Like manually finding correlations between 700 points and someone buys something would be infeasible, where throwing the whole data at a neural network was rather successful. Right, so as I said, my passion is machine learning, and early last year, I wanted to do something cool in machine learning, and I remember this quote of by Larry Ellison, who is the founder and CEO of Oracle. Apart from it being slightly sexist, I think it still holds true. And let me maybe prove that by asking a question. Please raise your hand if you use Apache Kafka at work. Well, that's I expected more actually. So I did this at a different conference, and like 40% raised their arms. And so the thing is, the follow-up question is, how many people of you think Apache Kafka is the perfect solution to the problem you're solving? And then half the arms went down. I'm not sure what if, yeah, I see nodding, so I guess it still holds true, even nowadays, that in the computer industry, we just go for the cool new kid on the block. So I realized that, and then I realized, looking at the landscape of machine learning that's out there are so many things, and it's so overwhelming that I need to do my own analysis of what tools are out there and what they're good for. And this is basically what I try to do with this talk, is lift the fork around the machine learning landscape a little bit. I'll be focusing on machine learning and then later on its subset of deep learning. So right, when you try to analyze the landscape of something that can be used to analyze data, I mean, what possible approach could you do? Obviously, you do that data-driven. So what I did was I compared a lot of tools based on certain features. I looked at the popularity of these tools, where I went to GitHub. I wrote a Python script to get the star count of GitHub for each of these tools. And the same thing with the questions that were asked. With this specific tag of one of those tools on Stack Overflow. I looked at some API docs, I played around with some tutorials, and when possible, included expert opinion and all that to get a better understanding of what kind of tools are out there and what are they capable of. That means if one of you have worked with, I don't know, PyTorch for the last 2.5 years, you're probably more an expert in PyTorch than I am. I have used some of these tools, but definitely not all of them. Right. But the thing is, lots of them are rather new, like 2, 3, maybe 3.5 years old. I don't think anyone on this planet can be an expert in all of them, so that saves me a little bit in that regard. So your question now is, Aiko, you spend all that time analyzing the landscape. So what is the best tool? And I have to disappoint you a little bit because I have to give you the classical consultant answer. It depends. It depends on a couple of things. It depends on the use case you're doing, whether you do image classification, be it for signature checking or for optical character recognition, or you want to do order prediction like we did at the client in Germany that I mentioned before. And I think in general, a good advice would be if the tool you're picking doesn't solve the problem you're having, don't pick that tool. That might sound obvious. I've seen cases where that advice wasn't followed. It also depends on your experience or your team's experience regarding the programming language that is used, regarding the tool themselves, also regarding the general understanding of machine learning. It depends on the infrastructure, whether your model will be running on a powerful server or on a mobile device, or whether the training of that model will happen with unlimited resources in the cloud, or whether it's on your laptop without a GPU. It depends on the structuredness of your data. So what kind of database is your data stored on? Is it in a graph database, or is it on a Hadoop cluster? Depends on the feasibility, and what I mean by that is, are you currently trying to figure out a general solution to the problem, or are you in some prototyping stage, or are you in production and you want to fine tune and tweak the last little bit out of your model? Right. And obviously, it depends on how much data you have. Like if you are training a model with Amazon's clickstream over the last 2 years. Or you train a model with your grandmother's cookie recipe collection, the amount of data might be different depending on your grandmother. And depends on lots of other things, like how much time you have, how much money you have, basically, how big the team is, etc. Right. To give you some insight on how I approached this whole thing, let's talk about TensorFlow a little bit. Anyone has not heard about TensorFlow by now? Everyone. It's by far the most popular deep learning framework with more than 100,000 stars on GitHub. And what I did is I had those four features, if you will, or four categories where I gave basically marks for all these technologies, where one is being the lowest and five is the highest. And I think the most obvious one is probably the ease of setup here with the two. And now the question is, why is that? And what I did was I went to the installation page of TensorFlow, how you install TensorFlow on Ubuntu. And that's what I got. In order to take this screenshot, I had to install a browser plugin that takes a screenshot, scrolls down, and like stitches all these pictures together. And now you're asking, if one is the lowest mark that framework can get, why is it still two? I did the same thing with the Microsoft Cognitive Toolkit. And this is what I got then. In Microsoft's defense, this is installing it on Ubuntu. Apparently, installing the Microsoft Cognitive Toolkit on Windows is rather easy. But maybe one quick question. Is anyone doing machine learning on Windows? Good to know. So to be true, to tell you the truth, this slide was made about a year ago. And the, especially in machine learning, everything is changing so fast. TensorFlow has drastically reduced the steps you need to take to install it. In fact, right now it's pip install TensorFlow. Then you have the CPU version. But the slide was too funny to skip it. right. There are a couple of other things. So even last year when this was the case and you had to go through all this pain to install it, why was TensorFlow so popular back then? TensorFlow does a couple of things right. It has this thing called TensorBoard, which is basically a real-time visualization of your training process. Other frameworks have picked that up as well, but TensorFlow had that from, I think, the first version 0.6 on, which is kind of cool because you can, in real time, see how your model behaves, how your accuracy is, your cost function. And it also is able to visualize the computational graph that you build. There are, however, a couple of things. So two other features that I had to look at is the degrees of freedom or the parameters exposed. Basically, how many hyperparameters can you play with? How much in detail can you go to fine-tune your model? And TensorFlow has a ton of options there. But that also means, so that's great for this. However, it also has, like pure TensorFlow has a pretty steep learning curve, which then affects the ease of use a little bit. I've already mentioned the adoption in the community, which itself, I mean, maybe in high adoption rate doesn't particularly say something is good, but what it can indicate is that if you run into problems and the community using that technology is rather large, then you have a high chance of getting actually some help from the community that's using it. Right, same thing I did for Keras. Well, Keras is, we've heard about it. Who does not know about Keras? All right, so I'll quickly talk about, Keras is not actually a deep learning framework. It's something like a higher level interface that you can put on top of deep learning frameworks. And it offers a more intuitive set of instructions. So you can easily build neural networks. So, for example, you can build a long short-term memory network in like 10 lines of code, which is pretty crazy. And it offers, due to that, it offers the fast prototyping. And you can explore solutions and build POCs. And Keras currently supports MXNet, Deep Learning 4J, TensorFlow, Microsoft Cognitive Toolkit, and Theano. And in fact, if you install TensorFlow, it's already built in, and you can use Keras even without separately installing it. The installation is basically, if you don't use TensorFlow where it comes by default, you can do pip install TensorFlow and then you get that. However, for the other cases, you need to have a separate, what they call backend, the deep learning framework where this Keras then works on top of. Right. That was about the methodology. One thing I did is I separated classical machine learning libraries or toolkits from deep learning, mainly, I mean, for several reasons. The resource requirements are different. All deep learning frameworks support GPUs. And after all, if you can find a linear model to find your to solve your machine learning problem, I would advise picking a straightforward model rather than going for a deep learning approach because it is a more complex system. And in general, if you can solve it the easy way, why not? Right. This is where I plotted these machine learning libraries against each other, where the adoption rate is on the x-axis and the degrees of freedom on the y-axis. And the ease of use is displayed by the size. And you On the very right of the chart, you can see weaker pipeline and Shogun. These haven't been particularly popular in the last time. In fact, PyBrain, I think the last change on the GitHub repository was like 2.5 years ago. Maybe there were 5 changes in the last 2.5 years, something like this. So I would consider that being discontinued. Weaker offers a graphical user interface, which also doesn't seem to be that popular. It is, however, popular when it comes to data mining. But I think the what I would call community kings on the left side of the chart, there's scikit-learn, which is, again, I would assume most of you have heard of, it's highly adopted in the community, offers a powerful interface to play with, and you can tweak your model with many different parameters. And then if you're working with Spark, there are these other three that are interested, you might be interested in. MLlib, which comes with Spark by default and even has a higher level wrapper, Spark ML, and H2O, which in some cases offers better results than Spark ML or MLlib. But then, even if you start with MLlib or Spark ML, you can just add H2O later on anyway. Another perspective when choosing a machine learning technology you might have is scalability. And we have, as I mentioned before, scikit-learn is highly adapted and offers a vast options for improving your model. It is, however, limited to run on a single machine. That doesn't particularly mean it's one thread or one process, because some algorithms can be implemented to run parallel. And as far as I know, scikit-learn has done that. However, if you can't like batch process your training, then you might have a problem because you're limited to the machine's memory. But if you don't need that amount of scalability and you don't need to go distributed and you don't have more memory than it fits, more data than it fits in memory, and you're comfortable with Python, then scikit-learn is a pretty safe bet. There are, however, H2O, MLlib, Apache Mahout, and Shogun, which, if you are more comfortable with Java, they would work quite well. And in fact, Apache Mahout, MLlib, and H2O can all run on top of an HDFS. So I guess the question you have to ask yourself is, one of the questions that you want to ask yourself is, whether you need distributed computing power, and whether the structuredness of your data being, whether it's running on HDFS or not. In fact, we talk about scalability here when we talk about deep learning frameworks that I will come to later. They are all highly scalable. And by later, I mean now. and there are a lot of deep learning frameworks. But all of these are mostly capable of running the same things that you have seen, that you could do with the non-deep learning libraries that I've shown before. It's just the case that in some areas, deep learning is significantly more successful. And some examples would be, I think computer vision is the prime example of where deep learning shines a lot and outperforms every other approach. Speech recognition is another example, audio recognition, and machine translation as well. But there are disadvantages to deep learning. It's more complex. The setup might be a little bit more difficult than for these frameworks. In general, you need a little bit more data. So there's something called transfer learning, where you can train your model with a certain data set, and then take that model and basically reuse it for a different use case and retrain it slightly.
We sort of set up everything here.
Right. So, but I've only seen this transfer learning being applied to.
Thank you very much.
You can still hear me, can't you? Okay. I've only seen transfer learning being applied to image recognition. So if you have structured data, I'm not aware that there's any, pre-trained structured data model that fits your, financial analysis, whatever you're analyzing. Another drawback of deep learning is it's difficult to comprehend. So what I mean by that is that the per feature importance is difficult to figure out it's difficult to figure out. So that means you put in some amount of data and then you get some output. Figuring out which of these particular data points are now responsible for creating that output is rather difficult. And I can think of an example where that would make me personally uncomfortable. Like if I go to a doctor.
I don't know, it was here, so maybe, okay, I thought it was the computer.
This is great. I tell the symptoms, and the doctor is typing the symptoms into a machine and into a deep learning model, and then the deep learning model tells me, hey, you have this condition. I would like the doctor to be able to verify why the deep learning model would suggest I have this condition now. Basically the simpler the model is, the more easy it is to get a direct relationship between a variable and the outcome later on. Right, so what do deep learning frameworks, probably all of you have seen neural network by now, so this is a neural network. Artificial neural network. We have some input nodes, and in this case, they're all connected to the next layer, to the nodes of the next layer. And then there's another hidden layer, and then an output layer, which gives you the result that you want. As mentioned before, deep learning would just have more of these hidden layers. this network is rather small. I'm not sure what it could do. So if you have an actual model, it would also have more nodes, not only more layers. But then the question is, why do we need deep learning frameworks? And all of these deep learning frameworks offer the basic building blocks of deep neural networks. So you can just say, give me a convolutional layer, and then you get a convolutional layer. And you can basically create all these layers. All these nodes do some kind of computation, you can get all these algorithms. You can use different functions that the deep learning model provides, and all of them are optimized, have an optimized implementation. I've said it before. All of these support GPUs, which is, the fact that we started putting all these computations are similar. The fact that we started putting them on single shaders on GPUs is one of the reasons why deep learning has been so successful over the years, over the last couple of years, and can in fact reduce training time from days and weeks up to down to hours. Right. So these are the frameworks you've just seen. Mapped against each other, where the adoption rate is on the x-axis and the degrees of freedom on the y-axis. And the ease of setup has the color accordingly to this thing here. And the size represents the ease of use. And I've already talked about TensorFlow and Keras. They are the most adopted, currently followed by PyTorch, and especially in combination where you have a TensorFlow backend and have Keras on top of that, they've been highly popular. Keras, as mentioned, is good for this prototyping, and you can quickly define your model. Where TensorFlow absolute outshines every other framework when it comes to deployment, whether you deploy it on a distributed system or on mobile devices. And if you use both of them, you get the best of both worlds. However, there are a couple of things. So debugging and all these fine tuning and whether you want to run, you can define to run on different multiple GPUs, all of that would still need to be in TensorFlow directly, and you can't do that through Keras. So in the middle, there's this blob of frameworks, which I would consider they're all fighting for attention. And the reason for that is, so there are quite a few big companies who have vast amount of data behind some of those frameworks. Data itself isn't particularly valuable if you can't get insights out of that data and you can't analyze it correctly. And therefore, all these companies like Facebook, Microsoft, Google, open sourcing these frameworks basically make it open for the community to improve upon brings value to at least to them. right. There is I call Keras and TensorFlow the community kings right now, but the strongest contender currently is PyTorch. PyTorch is a re-implementation of Torch. And PyTorch has been developed at Facebook. PyTorch is especially popular amongst researchers. PyTorch seems to pick up recent academic research results significantly faster than all the other ones. And that seems to be quite important for research. It also has, I don't want to go into detail there, but it has a dynamic graph creation, which TensorFlow now also has. In fact, I mentioned earlier that when I made the first TensorFlow slide, and that is a little bit outdated because the TensorFlow changed a little bit. Last week, TensorFlow 2.0 was announced, where there have quite a couple of changes. Quite a couple of implementations that actually take away this advantage from PyTorch. And then we have a couple of other ones. Theano, and I indicated that by this arrow, Theano was one of the first deep learning frameworks, was developed by the University of Montreal, but last year they actually stopped that project because they thought that the environment, the landscape has already matured enough, and Theano isn't necessary in that case anymore. Then there is Caffe, which has also been around for quite a while. There is Caffe too, which has also been developed by Facebook. Caffe is still around because it seems to be quite popular for image recognition. However, you for Caffe you define your model in YAML, and that doesn't seem to be up to date anymore. I mentioned PyTorch. Torch, the original, has a fairly small community. Maybe because it's written in Lua and you have to write Lua to use it. There's deep learning for J, as the name suggests. It supports Java. I think so that was that one overview. There is a different point of view question you might want to ask yourself when choosing a tool, and that is which part of the project lifecycle you are in. Some of them offer easy, fast prototyping. You can build your POCs fast, where others offer very fine-grained control to basically tweak your model and get the most out of that. And machine learning, or if you try to solve a problem with machine learning, the path to success is not always that obvious. Like if you developed normal software and you get your user story, you kind of know, okay, I have to do this, go to that class, do this, and then you do that, and then your story is done. With machine learning, you have to experiment a lot. You have to figure out which is the right model. I mean, there are some there are some ideas. If you do image recognition, you probably want some convolutional layers in there. But in general, there's a lot of exploration and try and error, basically, before you know which general model works good for your use case. So in the beginning, you need a technology that supports this kind of fast prototype. Where in later stages of the project lifecycle, you want something where you can get the last bit, the last 0.01% accuracy out of your model. And now, I mean, I'm basically telling you, you have to start writing everything like with the framework on this side, and then 6 weeks later, throw it away and start writing the same thing with a different framework, more on the fine-tuning or control side. Luckily, that would be horrible. Luckily, that's not the case. There are framework interoperability solutions being developed right now. And one of them is ONNX, stands for Open Neural Network Exchange, which is basically a common format of machine learning models that multiple of these frameworks use. So currently there's CAFI2, Microsoft Cognitive Toolkit, MXNet, and PyTorch, who store their model in this specific format. So what you can do is, and I've mentioned Facebook before because Facebook is developing PyTorch and CAFI2, and that's exactly what they're doing. They use PyTorch to design their model because it's easy, you can fast prototype, and then take that model, the exact same model, throw it onto CAFI2, and then let that run in production. And not only are these four that I've mentioned supported, but also like TensorFlow, for example, was not part of them. It's not storing their model in this specific format. However, there are converters that are able to convert TensorFlow models to ONNX, and I think it's bidirectional, I would guess so. Right. Another perspective I'd want to have when choosing a deep learning framework to solve a problem is basically a question you need to ask yourself. Are you solving a core problem, or are you solving a peripheral problem of your domain? And you are an online retailer, and product recommendation is probably one of the most important things of your business. And if you can make your product recommendation 0.1% better, that's cash, right? That's probably depending on your size, it can be millions of dollars. In that case, you do want the most fine-grained control you can get for this particular model, because it's cash, right? However, let me give you a different example. Imagine you're not an online retailer, but you're a dating site. And in order for users to sign up for this dating site, they need to upload an ID. For multiple reasons, people don't like uploading their IDs to some website. And we have like 50% of the pictures being uploaded is just not ID at all. It's like pictures of, I don't know, flowers, of the wall, of something. And the verification process for these IDs is currently being done manually. So we have like 5 people verifying these IDs. And half of these pictures they look at are rubbish. Now having a machine learning model that can filter out 80% of these non-ID pictures, that would be great, right? That would reduce manual labor and cost a lot. But do you really gain a lot from, like, if you create a 50 people team trying to optimize this use case? Probably not. So a question you have to ask yourself is, are you solving a peripheral domain or a core domain problem? So a couple of things I haven't talked about are these. I mean, I'm not actually talking about GCP and Azure and AWS, but all of these cloud providers have some machine learning as a service solutions available. but they are very specific. So you can, it usually is like an API where you upload something and then you get, I don't know, JSON back or like XML or whatever with the analysis of whatever you've uploaded. You can upload pictures and then you can do something like a landmark detection, or you can do face detection or speaker recognition and all these kind of things. But you usually can't train the model yourself. So you have to, you can do some things, but you have significantly less freedom as if you develop your machine learning or your deep learning solution yourself. But then again, if I can just upload all my pictures and Google tells me this is an ID or not, my problem is solved, right? So, I mean, as long as I'm fine with uploading IDs to one of those services and paying money for that. Let's skip that, actually. I hope I could give you like some idea of what the machine learning landscape currently looks like. And I hope I could make the point that you need to ask yourself a certain set of questions to make a reasonable decision on how to pick a machine learning tool. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Aiko. We have time for a couple of questions.
Hi, Aiko. I'm Amod. And first of all, really thanks for a very nice presentation. I really liked your slides and the way of presenting is really awesome. Regarding one of my questions, that since being a machine learning developer, I have a question that basically when we are kind of working on GPUs especially, which library or which kind of APIs we should prefer? Because basically it should be like Python and kind of TensorFlow or Python or OpenCV, or is any other GPU which we should kind of basically use which is freely available on the cloud? What's your thought on that?
Well, I think, again, it depends on what situation you are in. Whether, like, I would even argue that not for all cases, especially in terms of prototyping, you need a GPU. But then, as far as I know, when the, let's talk about deep learning, because then that's where GPUs become interesting. As far as I know, they all work on CUDA. And therefore, I don't see a particularly performance difference in most of them. If you need the highest possible performance, I think AWS has a couple of images where you can just like get some ML instance, and then that probably you can scale it up to whatever your bank account can pay for.
Further questions? If that is not the case, let's thank again Aiko. Very nice presentation.
Thank you. Thanks.